Jilka level, which is also called a sub-taluk level, I think probably in some of the states. And on the backside of the map, what we have done is the source of the flooding, the cause of flooding that happened during the major occurrence that happened there, and the rainfall data that was rainfall received in that particular area, and then relief centers operated to tide over the situation, number of persons evacuated, the number of days the relief camps were conducted, so that it gives an idea about the seriousness of the issue, vulnerability, and then what measures have been taken during the year in which the incident happened, and what are the permanent measures that have been taken to restore the damage that happened to the structure, and ultimately, what does the district administration suggest to put in place a permanent measure to prevent the disaster if possible, or try to reduce the risk to a greater extent. We do have special data in Tamil Nadu for administrative boundaries, health, hospitals, transport network, etc. And the integration of all these GIS layers is currently under progress. And very soon, I think we'd also like to have a product similar to what is there already in Pune, and then I think Orissa, Maharashtra and Orissa. Now, coming to the challenges, if you look at the challenges that are there, integration of legacy data vulnerability with forecast information from IMD, INCOIS, and CWC. There is a whole lot of information that is available in the state, with each and every district, with each and every taluk, the information is available. And this information, I think, if it is mined, and then the forecasts are correlated, integrated with that, it will be quite useful. And we need to develop a mobile-based application for gathering big data, both from multiple partners of government departments, as well as crowdsourcing of disaster-related data through social media platforms. Areas in harm's way to be identified real-time, to provide warnings and modifications to the stakeholders of pending, existing, or unfolding emergencies based on the location or areas to be impacted by the incident through push SMS. Another important challenge is validation and regular updation of the data. Development of simulation models by linking legacy data, rainfall data, and forecast data using predictive analytics and other data analytics to assess the inundation levels and vulnerability of different locations, including data from crowdsourcing during storm surge or any disaster, is going to be the real challenge. If we can develop that kind of a simulation models, definitely it is going to be a big boost for the district administration and the state level administrators in order to reduce the risk to a great extent, and particularly to minimize the loss of lives. You can act quickly to evacuate people to the relief centers. I would like to show the map that has been developed under NDM in version 2. I think some of the officers from ISRO, NRSC are here. This is a map. When I go to the website of NDM and then have a look at it for flood 2015 in Chennai, though it gives a full idea about the entire area of Chennai which has been inundated, unfortunately, it doesn't give the depth of each location, nor it does indicate the period of inundation in different locations of the city. And what is the vulnerable population? And then why is this problem happened? What is the major cause of this problem? This information is not there. Moreover, the information to the first responders is also not available. In fact, we are having a close dialogue with NRSC Hyderabad, and we intend to incorporate all these features also into the map. Today, we are able to manage this because 2015 is still fresh in our mind, and probably down the line after 15 to 20 years, if any person who is trying to address a flood-like situation in any district, unless he knows what are the highly vulnerable points, his energies are likely to be dissipated. That is the reason why we would like to have an improvement on the existing model. And in fact, we internally try to modify the map which has already been developed. So the red color indicates the areas, the specific dates on which these locations have been inundated. And we could also make out inundation areas where it was more than 2 to 3 days. Having discussed about the challenges, now I would like to make a few recommendations. This entire structure of the PPT presentation is based on the guidelines given by NDMA. So one of the important recommendations is capturing geotagged images of vulnerable areas. Here I would like to make a point. In all the presentations, in all the maps that have been shown, either it was being shown at the taluk level or at the district level or at the state level, I personally feel the entire taluk will not be affected.
Gopalji, please conclude now.
I can get you.
Please conclude.
Yes, I'll conclude quickly. The entire taluk will not be affected. Therefore, there is a strong need for every state to identify the specific locations which are highly vulnerable, and based on historical data, during and post-disaster phases, we need to geotag these pictures so that the field data and high-resolution satellite images can be integrated for emergency management. So I would like to recommend that every state, areas of very high vulnerability and high vulnerability should be mapped for different disasters using aerial photogrammetry, LIDAR, and also high-resolution satellite imagery for use on a GIS platform. GIS applications should be developed for efficient emergency management. Need to develop 3D, 2D simulation models for storm surge, flood inundation, seismicity to predict areas in the harm's way, intensity of the hazard, assess assistance required for rescue and evacuation, initiate arrangements for relief operations, and assist in prevention, preparation, and mitigation measures. To meet the emergency management needs, professional tools and technology such as data analytics, which includes descriptive analytics, predictive analytics, and prescriptive analytics are required. However, the technology has to be robust to withstand attacks of virus. WannaCry ransomware episode is too fresh in our mind. To conclude, technology is important, but institutional and organization strength are much more important. Thank you.
Thank you, Satya Gopal ji. Friends, though as per the program, we should have open forum discussion, but respecting the time, I will seek apology from the participants that since next session is proposed to start immediately at 4 without overshooting there, so we have to conclude this session. On my part, I will just take 2 minutes to provide very, very brief highlight of what has been said by different speakers. In fact, we started with the recognition of deficiency in data in the speech by Professor Anant. He just highlighted that how important is data to address this natural disasters. And he also shared that MOSPI has developed a system for collecting useful or needful data for addressing national disasters. I feel that we should make use of the system developed by MOSPI and put that into place. Right from beginning up to end, one common thread was that everybody highlighted the deficiency in data, the need for the data, and I think this is rightly so, because as some scholar said, something that can't be measured can't be improved. So we need to put things in quantitative framework. Then Dr. Kamal Kishore, he just shared with us that simple indicator could be tricky. Therefore, we have to look at the data before carefully interpreting it, and clubbing all the kind of disasters may be misleading, because some disasters which involve very high mortality rate are random kind of events. It's not like that flood and drought, which has less randomness, earthquake, cyclone, tsunami, they are very, very random events. So if you club those with others and just start concluding something, so that kind of conclusion may not be appropriate one. Dr. Dalal added another dimension to disasters, in fact, but came out is that disasters are also evolving. So a new category of non-conventional kind of disaster, which could be partly natural and which could be partly planned by certain groups, kind of thing. So we need to now expand our notion and our preparedness about disaster to include the possible threats from CBRN kind of things. Then we have perspective from Odisha. This just shows that as in UN we talk about learning from different countries, India is such a big country that experience of different states offer some useful lessons for national strategy and for strategy by other states. So very, very important. And again, some issues regarding data were raised that how you draw inference from population affected, when over time population is increasing, how you draw inference from economic loss, when over time the GDP is expanding. I think those are very, very preliminary things. MOSPI is equipped to address those kind of situation. So we should better take their advice that when things are changing, when things are growing, dynamics, so how we modify our indicator. It's very simple, it is not any rocket science kind of things, but we need to have take advantage of expertise that we have with the MOSPI. Then we have a presentation from Tamil Nadu. One message which comes from that is that capacity of the state to deal with natural disaster is very, very important. So we should not only be focusing on national capacity, the developing capacity of the states, because state is dealing on the ground. So developing capacity of the state is very, very important. And at the same time, we also need to improve our capacity of forecasting. We need to strengthen this capacity to minimize the errors. So these are some of the brief, very, very brief kind of takeaway, which I gather from the speech of co-chair and also from different panelists. I thank each one of them for rich presentation. We could not have much deliberations, and I find that the session was very interesting. I hope you also found it to be interesting. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Ramesh Chandra. NITMC Dr. Anil Gupta se nivedan karti hun ki Professor Ramesh Chandra ko aur sabhi dignitaries ko felicitate karein, unhe mementos pradan karein. Sabse pehle Professor Ramesh Chandra. Shri T.C.A. Anant. Shri P.K. Mohapatra, Shri Satya Gopal, thank you so much. Chai ke liye aap sabhi aamantrit hain, lekin we have to quickly resume back for the valedictory function. Manini Mantri ji aur Manini Mantri Gan, rather main kahungi wo 10 मिनट में ही पधारने वाले हैं, तो आप सभी से निवेदन करते हैं कि 5-7 मिनट में ही हम वापस यहाँ पर इकट्ठा होंगे हमारे समापन समारोह के लिए. बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद. आप सभी चाय पर सादर आमंत्रित हैं. आफ्टर 5-7 मिनट्स वी शैल रिज्यूम बैक हियर. थैंक यू सो मच.